Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Last Great War of Antiquity by James Howard-Johnston, narrated by Nigel Patterson. Preface. East-West conflict has been of perennial interest to historians, from the westernmost thrust of Persian power in the 5th century BC, when Xerxes attempted to conquer Greece, to the Cold War and the current rivalry between the old Western and the rising Eastern great power. All but one of the episodes of open warfare have had their historians, operating in the manner of Herodotus, but normally without his omnivorous curiosity. Politics being the prime subject matter of history in the classical period, and violent action by discrete political entities its most intense manifestation, contemporary and near-contemporary historians gave plenty of space in their works to the many wars fought by Romans against the loose-knit Parthian Empire and its more militarized Sasanian successor. The roll call of historians runs from Tacitus in the heyday of the Principate and Ammianus Marcellinus in the 4th century to Procopius and his three successors, Agathias, Menander Protector and Theophylact Simocata, who between them covered the four wars fought in the 6th century. Then, after a gap which this book is designed to fill, came the earliest Islamic historians, who, from the 8th century, pieced together narratives out of antecedent material about the Arab conquests, beginning with a victory over Roman forces not far from Gaza in 634. Their successors and their Christian counterparts covered the confrontations of Islam with Byzantium and Latin Christendom and the outward drive of the Ottomans. The gap extends from 602 to 630. The grisly end of the Emperor Maurice and five of his six sons in November 602, after a military coup mounted by the Balkan Field Army and its new commander Phocas, provided the Sasanian king Khosrow II with the pretext he needed to go to war to reassert the traditional parity of Persians with Romans. For Maurice was Khosrow's benefactor, having restored him to the Sasanian throne, but he had demanded large, damaging territorial concessions. The war broke out in spring 603 and was only brought to an end 2 years after the overthrow and execution of Khosrow, when a durable peace was negotiated by his daughter Boran with Phocas's nemesis and successor Heraclius in summer 630. There is evidence about the war, but it is fragmentary and scattered across different types of source in different languages. It is a painstaking and time-consuming process to extract, vet, and piece together the bits of information into some sort of coherent story. That may partly explain why there is no full, solidly founded critical history of the last war between the two established great powers of Western Eurasia at the end of antiquity. Learned articles have been written on individual episodes and on ideological aspects of the conflict. Many wider-ranging works, from Gibbon's Decline and Fall to that recent worldwide sensation Peter Frankopan's Silk Roads, include outline accounts of the fighting, but they view it primarily as a precursor to the rise of Islam. Only two connected accounts of the whole war have been published, neither of which is grounded in comprehensive critical analysis of the primary material. One, the first volume of Andreas Stratos's Byzantium in the 7th century, simply recycles what is chronicled by the sources, while the other, Walter Kagi's Heraclius, Emperor of Byzantium, covers the fighting, but is primarily concerned with the feats of one important participant. A great deal of time has been consumed in research for this book. A prophecy of my wife's, that it would take as long to write as the events took to unfold, has, I fear, come true. Serious work began in autumn 1990, when I started a year's sabbatical leave. I am topping and tailing the 11 chapters, none very skimpy, into which it is divided, nearly 27 years later and deep into defunctitude, also known as retirement from university teaching, dubbed the twilight of the scholar by the young graduate students who enliven my existence. It is, I must confess, even worse than that. For the original inception of the project dates back to the early 1980s and took the form of a skeleton chronology, handed out to undergraduate takers of an optional course in 6th and 7th century Middle Eastern history at Oxford. So what faces the listener is the product of nearly 40 years' work at the coalface of knowledge. That, as well as convenience, explains the old-fashioned terminology, Monophysite and Nestorian, used for non-Chalcedonian confessions. Miaphysite and Church of the East are now preferred. There were, I am glad to say, some byproducts, learned papers delivered at conferences, cited in the bibliography, and a book, Witnesses to a World Crisis, which laid down the historiographical foundations. The structure which rises from those foundations has acquired considerable bulk, despite unrelenting efforts to keep footnotes short and to limit references to primary sources and a necessary minimum of secondary works. I hope that the bulk will not be too off-putting. I have benefited from scholarly company of all sorts over these 40 years, above all from my undergraduate pupils with whom I discussed the last great war of antiquity in tutorials from the 1980s to 2009. They have been replaced since 2009 by a small number of young scholars with whom I have been meeting weekly in term to read texts in Ethiopic, Arabic and Syriac. I am immensely grateful to Phil Booth, Marek Yankoviak, Ed Sikovich Coghill, a fine Arabist whom I cannot help but call professor, and Simon Ford, not merely for helping me to plug shameful gaps in linguistic competence, but also for innumerable discussions of historical issues. There are many, many other debts, to faculty and college colleagues, to the graduate students with whom I like to hobnob in these declining days, to participants in several conferences on Sasanian history and archaeology held since the 1990s, to the conference on the reign of the Emperor Heraclius, organised by Gerrit Reining and Bernhard Stolter at Groningen in 2001, to the 7th century Syrian numismatic round table, which meets at intervals of 2 to 3 years, and to travelling companions on journeys to Iran, Tunisia, Armenia and Algeria over the last 2 decades, for the ideas and banter exchanged. Although it may be invidious to single them out, and there is always the danger that someone who should be mentioned may be omitted, let me thank in particular the following for their contributions of information and ideas. 1. On the Sasanians, Richard Payne, the late Ze'ev Rubin and Josef Wieserhofer. 2. On pre-Islamic Arabia, Michael MacDonald. 3. On numismatics, Tony Goodwin, Rika Giselin, Cecile Morrison and Susan Tyler Smith. 4. On archaeology, the late Judith McKenzie, Jody Magnus, the late Boris Marshak, Eberhard Sauer, St. John Simpson and Alan Walmsley. And 5. On texts, Michael Jackson Bonner, Tim Greenwood, David Gyllenhaal, the late Cyril Mango, and Mary Whitby. Finally, there are 3 scholars to whom I owe a particularly large debt. Phil Booth, with whom I have analysed the text of John of Nicaea, and who has read and helped to improve several chapters. Marek Yankoviak, first leader of our Arabic reading group, with whom I have been wrestling over certain historical crises since we first met 10 years ago, and Constantin Zuckerman, Marek's former supervisor, whom I regard as a peerless scholar of this period and a formidable antagonist when we disagree, as we do from time to time. In addition, I am most grateful to the Oxford University Committee for Byzantine Studies for allowing me to keep an office in the Ioannou Centre for Classical and Byzantine Studies for all these years of defunctitude. J. H. J. Temple House, Temple End, Harbury, November 2017. Postscript. 3.5 years have passed by since I wrote about the magnificent deformation of history in Corneille's Heraclius at the end of this book. Scholars of late antiquity and Byzantium have been as active as ever in adding to knowledge and understanding. I have cited a few recent publications of particular importance, none more so than T.B. Mitford, East of Asia Minor, Rome's Hidden Frontier, 2 volumes, Oxford 2018, a gripping exploration of the Euphrates Limes. Otherwise, the text is unchanged. Finally, I am indebted to Callan Maynell for adding that vital component of any work of history, the index. Brighton, February 2021. Introduction. It was not a war to end all wars. It was not a war to destroy or truncate the Roman Empire in the East. The Persian aim at the outset was not even regime change, merely restoration of an ousted regime. But the fighting went on and on. There was a steady escalation in its scope and intensity with the passing years. After a decade of conflict, foreboding came upon contemporaries. The saints were plainly withdrawing their favour from mankind. God was turning his face from the present generation. The world and all things in it were being troubled because of man's sinfulness, and those few who strove to squeeze out desire, ambition, envy, and other human feelings from their lives should withdraw and pray for a softening of God's anger. For one distant observer, far to the south of the Fertile Crescent, where the two belligerent great powers were engaged in combat, the war presaged the end of time. The last days were at hand, when the earth would shake and the seas boil, when the sky would be torn apart and the stars scattered, when men would come face to face with the creator and manager of all things. The last and longest war of classical antiquity was fought in the early 7th century. It opened in summer 603, when Persian armies launched coordinated attacks across the Roman frontier, taking advantage of a violent change of regime in Constantinople. 25 years later, the fighting stopped after a bold, almost insanely bold, Roman thrust into the Persians' Mesopotamian heartland. This triggered a virtually bloodless putsch against a king, Khusro II Parvez, whose achievements, up to 626, had surpassed those of all his ancestors. 2 years of tortuous negotiations followed before the Romans were able to reach a durable peace agreement in 630, with the third of three ephemeral Persian regimes. It was a conflict of more than passing significance, given the scale and intensity of the fighting. The two long-established empires of Western Eurasia, the East Roman and the Sasanian, committed all available resources to the struggle. Military operations took place along the full length of the frontier, from Transcaucasia in the north to the Badia, the swathe of grazing land fringing the Arabian desert in the south. The great powers of the outer steppe world were drawn in. The Turks, who in the 550s and 560s had founded the first transcontinental empire, stretching eventually from the inner Asian frontiers of China to the Crimea, intervened first on their own initiative in 615, when they raided deep into Iran, and then, at Roman invitation, in the last years of the war, 626 to 629, when they tipped the balance decisively in the Romans' favour. The nomad ally courted by the Persians was the Avar Khaganate, which, from the 560s, was able to project its power outward from a core territory in the Carpathian Basin. The Avars were no match for the Turks, from whom they had fled to the west, but they could apply pressure on the Balkans, either using the Slavs as surrogates from before 620, as previously in the 570s and 580s, or launching direct attacks on Thessalonica and Constantinople, as they did in 622, 623 and 626. The war was raised onto a high ideological plane. The Romans exploited religion to an unprecedented degree. For them, it was a head-on conflict between faiths, of Christians, who worshipped the true God and were led by God's vice-regent on earth, against impious Zoroastrians, whose king delighted in bloodshed and sacrilege. The sacking of Jerusalem in 614 and the removal of the fragments of the true cross provided rich veins for propaganda. Later, Roman troops, at least those serving on the bold counteroffensive campaigns of 624 to 626 and 627 to 628, were offered the rewards of paradise if they laid down their lives for the cause. The Persians could not respond in kind, given that they had long accepted the religious pluralism of their subjects. but they could take inspiration from the mythical version of the deep past, which was recorded in the official dynastic history, the Quadena Mag, Book of Lords. They could strive to emulate the Kayanid rulers of Iran, whose feats surpassed those of the Sasanians' real but forgotten Achaemenid predecessors. There was therefore no reason for them to shy away from the prospect of reasserting Iran's position as the sole great power of the sedentary world, after they had broken into the Roman Levant and had divided the empire in two. Hence Khusro's fateful decision to eradicate Roman rule from the Middle East, which shaped the second half of the war. Ambition was the driving force behind the escalation evident from winter 615 to 616. It was an ambition on the point of realization as the war entered its final climactic phase in the early 620s. The whole Roman Middle East was under Persian rule, including the breadbasket of the East Mediterranean, Egypt, and the empire's main commercial and manufacturing centres in the Levant and Egypt. Persian forces were poised to invade Asia Minor, the last remaining substantial landmass under Roman control. Apart from regular annual pauses in winter, traditionally the season when belligerents consolidated their positions, engaged in diplomacy, and devised plans for future action, there was no interruption to the campaigning. Towards the end, even winter was being eroded, as the last army which could be put into the field by the Romans, and which was commanded by the Emperor Heraclius in person, showed itself adept at continuing operations well beyond the end of autumn. The resources of both sides, in terms of ideology, finance, manpower and materiel, were exploited to an unprecedented extent. The stamina of both was being tested as never before. It is a war which demands attention as the final episode in classical history, forming a pendant to the great war between the free cities of Greece and the Achaemenid Empire, fought over a millennium earlier. The drama was great, as one empire gradually bludgeoned the other to death. But then, in a remarkable reversal of fortune, the defeated and doomed Roman Empire struck back and dealt a series of mortal blows to the prestige and domestic political standing of the victorious Persian king. The war was also the prelude to a yet more dramatic episode in the history of the world, an episode which was the analogue, on the plane of human affairs, to the Big Bang, namely the rise of Islam, the definitive destruction of the ancient world order, as the Arabs conquered three of the four power centres of the Middle East, and a decisive shift of the economic centre of gravity of Western Eurasia, from Egypt and the Eastern Mediterranean to Iraq and Iran. Narrative history now has an old-fashioned air about it, although the historian's first and fundamental task has always been to scour the sources for evidence and to piece together chronologically ordered accounts of events. For Europe and China from antiquity, for the Middle East and the lands conquered by Islam from the 8th century, for the Americas, Africa and the Antipodes in the colonial period, the creation of a history of events was the collective achievement of successive generations of scholars, antiquarians and historians, especially those at work in Europe, in the 18th, 19th and early 20th centuries. It was therefore not unreasonable for the Annales school in France at the end of the Second World War, and their many foreign admirers, to be blasé about histoire événementielle. The historian's task, in their view, was to understand and to explain historical phenomena, most of which were well established. They turned their attention to the analysis of structures, economic, social, institutional, and cultural. They have spread out to tackle innumerable specific topics. There has been an extraordinary proliferation of learned publications, daunting in the extreme to the lay reader. But blank, or largely blank, areas remain, some very large, like the history of India and its cultural dependencies in Southeast Asia before the first inroads of Islam, which brought with it the history-writing habit, some small, and caused either by temporary failings in contemporaries' coverage of events in historically mature societies, or because of a dearth of modern research in particular fields of inquiry. In such cases, the first duty of the historian is to trace out a sequence of events through time, to arrange them into successive episodes, and to observe possible causal connections. The last great war of antiquity is one such case, because no one has hitherto set out to tell the story of what happened with proper attention to the full range of preserved data. It has been covered fleetingly in general histories of the classical and medieval Mediterranean and Middle East, as well as the many outline histories of Byzantium which have been hitting university bookshelves over the last two decades. Even the conference on the reign of Heraclius held in Groningen in 2001 shied away from military and diplomatic history. Individual episodes have been subjected to minute scrutiny. They include the siege and sack of Jerusalem in 614, the subsequent establishment of Persian control over the Roman Levant, perilous moments in the history of Thessalonica, 620 and 622, Heraclius's narrow escape from capture at the hands of the Avars, 623, the joint Avar-Persian attack on Constantinople, 626, Heraclius's Persian campaigns, 624 to 626, 627 to 628, the identity of the bride promised to the Turkish Kagan at his summit meeting with Heraclius, and negotiations between Heraclius and the great Persian general Shahrbaraz during and after the war. The sources have been probed and examined thoroughly in the recent past, which has rendered them usable to the historian, but only three historians have ventured to write histories combining a broad sweep with a close grip on particulars. All three have viewed the war from the Roman perspective and have had difficulty in achieving a balance between military and diplomatic narrative on the one hand, and analysis of causes, motivations, aims, and outcomes on the other. Byzantium in the 7th century, 602-634, Amsterdam, 1968, written by the late Andreas Stratos, is a lineal descendant of medieval Byzantine historical compilations, like those of Theophanes and his many successors, in which notices were pieced together out of earlier sources. Stratos was able to draw on a much larger pool of information, but like them, he restricted himself to the arrangement of the raw material into a linear sequence. His is naked narrative history, stripped of much of the commentary and interpretation necessary to make sense of it. It is also innocent, since Stratos takes on trust much of the tendentious material put into circulation at the time. John Haldane's Byzantium in the 7th Century, The Transformation of a Culture, Cambridge 1990, veers to the opposite extreme. Narrative is reduced to a bare minimum to leave as much space as possible for analysis of institutions, social developments, and ideological changes. Finally, there is Walter Kagi's Heraclius, Emperor of Byzantium, Cambridge 2003. He does allocate plenty of space to military operations. He has taken note of topographical features and picks out the tactical rationale behind army movements. But like Stratos, he is liable to be taken in by contemporary black propaganda and unreliable anecdotal material, and struggles at times to sort out chronology. The biographical format also works to the disadvantage of diplomatic as well as military history, since he is more concerned to track Heraclius, if necessary with much conjecture, than to place the war in its wider West Eurasian context. There is much disentangling of chronology to be done, as well as much vetting of the information transmitted to us before events can be put into their proper chronological order and a first attempt can be made to see their patterning. The geography of the Middle East, above all that of the fortified zones on either side of the frontier, must also be surveyed and its articulation understood before individual campaigns can be interpreted. The military historian must strive to see the ground as it was seen at the time by the generals in command. This means an appreciation of the general configuration of the land, the alignments of the major mountain chains and great rivers which defined regions, and the disposition of important resource bases, agricultural or pastoral, which determined the distribution of population. Major through routes must be traced, that is, routes feasible for large, organised bodies of men accompanied by wheeled transport carrying supplies and equipment. Narrow passages and mountain passes, where armies on the march would be especially vulnerable to attack, must be identified, and their defences, if any, located and appraised. There is much else to attend to. The location, size and defensive strength of major cities, the density and effectiveness of purpose-built military installations, internal communications and assembly places necessary for the mobilisation of large armies, highland regions with reservoirs of fighting manpower, and so on. With knowledge of terrain and monuments of many sorts put up by man, military operations can at last be followed on the ground, with the help of precise data extracted from the sources, about commanders, troop strengths, times and places, routes and distances, cities and forts, marches and manoeuvres, engagements and sieges, and so on. Individual operations can be linked together to form campaigns, each with its own rationale, and individual campaigns can then be viewed as component parts of larger strategies. In almost all cases, however, motivation and intention, the immediate driving forces behind operations, have to be teased out from actions carefully tabulated in space and time. The evidence is indirect, rather than coming from records of debate and decision-making. We know that governments and high commands on both sides paused occasionally to take stock and to plan ahead. The Persians, after the initial battles and victories of 603 to 605, and again in winter 615 to 616, after the arrival of a grovelling plea for peace from the Roman Senate, the Romans, almost certainly once Heraclius had seized power in October 610, and some 11 years later, after the loss of Egypt. This last round of planning is reported by George of Pisidia, who tells us that Heraclius and his entourage spent much of the winter of 621 to 622 considering their options, caught as they were between Western and Eastern adversaries. He simply notes the final decision, which was to take the offensive in Asia Minor. How one longs for even a few fragments of papers produced for those meetings, distant precursors of the invaluable documentation generated by Churchill's entourage in the run-up to summit meetings in the Second World War. Instead, we have to fumble around, hoping to pick up key strands in the thinking of the small elites who devised the plans and attempted to direct the operations of large groups of men at a distance. Military campaigns must be placed in the wider context of international relations at the time, what was happening on other fronts, what diplomatic initiatives were being launched, whether relations were improving or deteriorating with other powers. War must never be dissociated from its accompanying diplomacy. In the case of the Persian-Roman War of 603 to 630, examination of the diplomatic context helps to explain the outcome of individual campaigns and the war as a whole. The various diplomatic documents reproduced and summarised in the sources also provide vital insights into Persian and Roman motivations. But we must be careful, for there is always the danger of mistaking bluff for underlying policy and negotiating position for serious aim, not to mention the many traps laid by the propaganda broadcast by both sides. It is no easy task to write the history of the last great war of antiquity. Innocence is the great enemy, closely followed by an excess of suspicion, which may result in over-ingenious interpretation. Gaps in the narrative can only be filled by conjecture, which must be kept in hand. Attitudes and aims are all too often out of reach. But given the importance of the war, it is worth making the effort to describe its course and to identify some of the factors which influenced its course and outcome. 1. Khusro's War of Revenge. After nearly 20 years of unremitting military effort by the Emperor Maurus, the strain was beginning to show in 602. His achievements were far from negligible. Civil war in Persia had been successfully exploited to bring the conflict initiated by Justin II to a close on highly advantageous terms. In the second half of the reign, free to concentrate his forces in Europe, Maurice had succeeded in cowing the Avars and had begun the painstaking process of pacifying the Slavs who had settled in the Balkans. In Italy, making the most of the resources to hand, he had striven to pen the Lombards back into the central Po Valley and the mountain territories which they had seized. It was plain, though, that Roman authority could not be reimposed within former Roman territory without a continuing military commitment on a large scale. The gains would be undramatic. The costs were already obvious and keenly felt. Resentment was growing against Maurice's regime. The Slavs were loosely organised and elusive in their forest lairs. Impressive displays of Roman military power might be laid on, as they were in the years 593 to 595. Expeditionary forces, as long as they took due precautions, were able in those years to cut at will through Slav tribal territories on either side of the lower and middle Danube, while other units intercepted raiding bands. Tribes in those relatively accessible areas could be brought under military control in a relatively short time, but years of patient and delicate administrative effort, backed by localized military action and propaganda, would be required to imbue them with Roman culture and to extend Roman authority further afield into the remoter uplands. Every available interlude of peace or comparative peace would have to be devoted to this task, building on the successes achieved during a short-lived treaty with the Avars, late 595 to mid-596, and a later lull in Roman-Avar fighting in 600 to 601. Only then would such cities as survived in the northern and inner provinces of the Balkans be able to re-establish control over their hinterlands. Only then would those provinces be effectively reintegrated into the empire. The second decade of Maurice's reign provided sobering experience of how little could be achieved, even when there were no serious distractions elsewhere. The Avars, though on the defensive for much of the time, remained a formidable adversary, as they demonstrated in 597 to 598, when they made a surprise attack, trapped and blockaded one Roman general in Tomi on the Black Sea, routed a second as he came to his colleague's relief, and then advanced south towards Constantinople. The consequences for Roman prestige among their recently acquired Slav subjects and for the maintenance of Roman control over them would have been catastrophic but for an outbreak of plague which halted the invading army in its tracks and forced the Khagan to negotiate a renewal of the lapsed peace on improved terms for him. Even though the Roman field army pressed home its temporary advantage in 599 and invaded Pannonia, even though Roman diplomats then managed to win over the Antae, Gothic-influenced Slavs living beyond the lower Danube, and through them triggered revolts among other Avar subjects in 601, the Avar Khaganate was too well organised and resilient to be in danger of imminent collapse. It was to remain a major, menacing power on the edge of Roman territory in Europe for many years to come. In autumn 602, substantial field forces were deployed in the Danube region. The troops, who had probably not forgotten a previous attempt of Maurice's to improve cost efficiency in winter 593 to 594, were far from content at the prospect of more years of campaigning in inhospitable terrain and often unpleasant weather. Now came an order that they were not to return to winter quarters and enjoy a respite from fighting. Instead, they were to remain north of the Danube and to keep up the pressure on the belt of Slavs adjoining Roman territory. For the Slavs would be at their most vulnerable in winter, when the deciduous forests provided thinner cover. When the order was announced, there was an outcry in the ranks, and soon deep reluctance to obey developed into open mutiny. In Italy, Maurice's drive to reassert effective Roman authority over the Lombards came to naught for lack of the necessary military force. Italy plainly ranked third after the East and the Balkans in East Roman priorities, as it had done for all but 4 years, 551 to 554, since its initial recovery in 540. The regional supremo, the exarch based in Ravenna, had to magnify the limited military power which he could bring to bear by diplomacy and subversion. There was no hope of reasserting Roman authority unless direct action by the exarch's forces was supplemented by Frankish military intervention on a large scale and by coordinated rebellions on the part of suborned Lombard dukes, as happened in 590. There were some subsequent successes, notably the recovery of Perugia, a vital strategic position on the trans-Apennine route between the Exarchate and Rome. The Roman authorities held on to several key cities, Padua, Cremona, and Mantua, from which they could keep the core territory of the Lombards in the central plain north of the Po under surveillance. The Lombards of Spoleto were also deterred from pressing against Rome itself from their Apennine redoubts. But overall Roman operations proved counterproductive. King Agilulf, 590 to 616, was antagonized by the capture and detention of his daughter and son-in-law in 599 and set about changing the balance of power on the ground. He attacked key fortified cities in the Po Valley and negotiated an alliance with the Avar Khaganate. Padua fell after a long siege in 601. Istria was subjected to concerted attack by Lombards and Avars in 602, after which the refractory Lombard dukes of Trento and Cividale were won over by Agilulf, 603. It was only after Maurice's fall, in November 602, and the loss of Cremona, the 20th of August, and Mantua, the 13th of September, in 604, that a new exarch agreed a truce with Agilulf, and finally, after threatening Lombard moves in northern Umbria, negotiated a full peace treaty. This came into force in November 605 and was to last for many years. The price was considerable. The release of grand hostages with their children and possessions and a payment of 12,000 solidi. A crisis was also developing in Armenia. Roman attempts to sponsor the Chalcedonian Rite, including the appointment of a Chalcedonian Catholicos, had caused widespread resentment in a region where the rival Monophysite confession was deeply entrenched. The new Catholicos, who was installed at Theodosiopolis, capital of the old Roman sector of Armenia, where his safety could be guaranteed, did not smooth matters when he appropriated the plate and other movable property of his Monophysite rival, who continued to reside at Dvin, just over the frontier. The Armenian nobility and fighting classes were being antagonized at the same time by the strenuous efforts of Maurice's regime to transform Armenia into a recruiting ground and to send the troops raised there to the Balkans. The losses suffered, and also doubtless the unpleasant conditions encountered, were alienating the loyalties of Armenians at home as well as in the field. The problems engendered by these policies were compounded by a mood of heightened national awareness dating from 572, when, with covert Roman support, disaffected elements in Pers-Armenia organised a general uprising. Hopes raised then had been dashed but not forgotten when the Sasanians reimposed their authority by 578. They were reawoken when much of Armenia was prized loose from Sasanian control in 591, and manifested themselves thereafter in sporadic anti-Roman agitation. It was, of course, quite natural for Armenians to vent their disgruntlement and frustration on the currently dominant power in the region, irrespective of that power's specific policies towards them. But there was all too sharp a contrast between the heroic battles on the fringes of the steppe fought by Armenian forces recruited from the Persian sector, battles from which their general, Sambat Bagratuni, accumulated unrivalled prestige at home, and the hard slog in the cold and wet of the Balkans endured by those recruited by the Romans from their sector. A rebellion was nipped in the bud late in 601, when a hitherto loyal Armenian commander slipped across the Dardanelles and rode with a small body of companions back to Armenia. The Magister Militum there had been alerted and moved quickly to arrest the rebels, going so far as to pursue them onto Sasanian territory and to besiege them in Nakhchivan until a Persian army approached. Now, in 602, came news that the emperor was planning to transplant 30,000 cavalrymen and their families permanently to Thrace. Priscus, one of Maurice's four senior and most trusted commanders, was detailed to organise the delicate operation and was on his way to Armenia. There were ominous signs of increasing disaffection elsewhere in the empire. Egypt, the richest of all the empire's provinces, had been disturbed by two rebellions earlier in Maurice's reign. One originated in factional rivalries in three cities near Alexandria. It escalated rapidly. The rebel leaders, four notables belonging to the same family, were able to mobilise support against the provincial authorities on a scale large enough to disrupt Alexandria's communications up the Nile and across the Mediterranean, as well as to encourage insurrection elsewhere in Egypt. The authorities had to draw on all available military resources, including those of Nubia, to suppress it. The second was little more than a grand act of brigandage involving the seizure of provincial tax revenues. At the approach of loyalist troops, the rebel leader and his band of lawless men and Ethiopian slaves fled to a natural stronghold where they managed to hold out for a while. The underlying cause is probably to be found in the financial strain caused by the inflated military budget needed to fund the heroic enterprise of restoring Roman rule in the Balkans. Certainly the main target of the opposition was the empire's chief financial officer, Constantine Lardis, Praetorian prefect of the East, as was made plain when his Constantinopolitan house was burned down on the night of rioting which drove Maurice from power. There was a worrying incident in Constantinople early in 602. The immediate cause was a food shortage. As the emperor was going barefoot through the city in procession on the night of the 1st to the 2nd of February, stones were thrown at him. A feigned attack by his bodyguard brandishing iron clubs temporarily dispersed the crowd and enabled him, together with Theodosius, his eldest son, to proceed to Blakernai and celebrate the purification of the Virgin Mother at her church there. But the crowd regrouped and demonstrated its opposition by guying the emperor. A bald man who looked like Maurice was put on a donkey, crowned with a wreath of garlic, and then taunted with various mocking shouts. The crowd likened him to a cock mounting a soft, sensuous heifer and fathering children like Xilocucuda, hard seed, accused him of muzzling dissent and asked God to strike him on the head. By the autumn, Maurice's position had become much weaker. While he was able to extract declarations of loyalty from the partisans of both blue and green racing colours in the Hippodrome before the mutinous Balkan Expeditionary Army reached the capital, and felt able to assign them roles in the defence of the city, their commitment was easily frayed as the political crisis developed. Both groups deserted him before the rebel army reached the suburbs. 1.1. Phocas's seizure of power. In the Balkans, the expeditionary force had completed an anti-Slav sweep on the north bank of the Middle Danube and was withdrawing when the emperor's order arrived. The troops remonstrated with their commander-in-chief, the emperor's brother Peter, but he stood by the order. At this, they mutinied, crossed the Danube back onto Roman territory at Palastulum, and marched downstream to Securisca. But their resolve was weakening. An offer of increased pay and rations to compensate them for the hazardous and unpleasant conditions which they faced probably helped to bring this about. Certainly they agreed to construct the boats needed to ferry the army back across to the north bank, and were doing so when they got their first taste of the winter to come, furious storms and the onset of cold. Their opposition revived, and they refused to cross the river. An 8-man deputation was sent to reason with Peter at his headquarters, which he had kept at a safe distance from the main camp since the beginning of the mutiny. He agreed to come and address the troops on the following day. He gave no ground when he did so, and insisted that orders be obeyed. First, he addressed a meeting of senior officers, taxiarchi, reading out the latest letter from the emperor. They were unmoved and came out firmly in the troops' favour. When he took the same adamant line in his speech to the full assembly of the army, there was an outcry and the meeting broke up. The troops then convened their own assembly, at which we may presume they reiterated their opposition. At a second assembly on the following day, they elected Phocas their leader and raised him on a shield, thereby proclaiming him their candidate for the throne. So bad was Phocas's subsequent reputation as a ruler, so eager was Heraclius to blacken his name, both before and after his own seizure of power, that very little is reported in the extant sources about his background and previous career. The most informative is a contemporary chronicler, the continuator of John of Antioch. He notes that Phocas came from Thrace, that he was 55 years old, married to Leontia, and with a daughter named Domentia after his mother. He gives the lie to Simocatta, who assigns him the lowly rank of centurion. For John's account of the deputation sent on an earlier occasion to lodge the army's complaints against Comintilus, Peter's predecessor, in command until winter 600-601, makes it plain that Phocas was one of its leading members. It was Phocas who presented the deputation's case most forcefully at an imperial audience, and who was the last to leave, thus giving an enraged patrician the opportunity to assault him. He represented the army again on the deputation sent to Peter at Securisca. There is, therefore, nothing inherently improbable in the claim made in the Egyptian chronicle of John of Nicaea, and possibly derived from a lost part of the continuation of John of Antioch, that Phocas was one of four senior commanders in Thrace in autumn 602. The army now prepared to march on Constantinople under Phocas's command. Two of his rivals for the rebel leadership, Alexander and Lilius, both likewise senior commanders, were sent ahead to Constantinople, presumably in the hope that they might be able to negotiate a peaceful transfer of power. Meanwhile, Peter fled together with officers who had joined him from the main camp and sent a messenger ahead to inform the emperor of what was happening. Maurice's first action on hearing the grim news was to keep it secret for as long as possible and to hold special chariot races in the hippodrome as if nothing were amiss. When the news broke, he extracted public declarations of support from both blue and green circus factions and organised the defence of the capital, allocating stations on the Theodosian walls to faction members. Phocas's emissaries were not admitted to the city when they arrived, and were only able to make contact with one person who slipped out. All they could do was to go back to the rebel army as it was continuing its march. Maurice made no attempt to hold the long wall which ran from the Marmara to the Black Sea coast, some 60 to 70 kilometres from Constantinople. The advance units of the rebel army crossed it unopposed. It was now Maurice's turn to try to negotiate, but without success. Phocas evidently insisted that Maurice must abdicate. The defences of the city were activated and put in the hands of Germanus, a magnate with an extraordinarily distinguished lineage, who could be trusted because of a double marriage link. He and Maurice had married sisters, daughters of the Emperor Tiberius, 578-582, and he had recently become Theodosius's father-in-law. A breach was achieved before the full rebel army arrived, by what appears to have been a highly successful piece of disinformation on the part of the rebels. They had let it be known that they would support the candidature of Maurice's eldest son, Theodosius, or of his father-in-law, Germanus, if either were willing to join in the attempt to oust Maurice. A letter expressing this view was rumoured to have been received by Theodosius when he was out hunting with Germanus before the rebels made the approaches to the city unsafe. Credence was given to the story when a rebel foray raided the horses grazing outside the city and carefully spared those belonging to Germanus. Soon the story reached the emperor's ears and led him, as intended, to suspect Germanus of treason. On the following day, the 21st of November, he dismissed him from his command, replacing him with Comintilus, an appointment which was not calculated to appease the rebel army. Then, on the 22nd of November, he summoned Germanus and confronted him with the evidence of his treason. Although Germanus defended himself vigorously and was allowed to leave the audience, it was evident that the emperor was not convinced of his innocence. Germanus made his way home along the Messe, the main east-west street. A natural anxiety about his own safety had been sharpened by a whispered warning from Theodosius as he left the emperor's presence. That afternoon, accompanied by his armed retinue, he took refuge in a nearby church. Events now began to move fast. When the news of Germanus's action reached Maurice at dusk, he sent a high-ranking palace official, the eunuch Stephen, Theodosius's tutor, to persuade him to come out. In this, he failed completely. He was manhandled out of the church and abused by Germanus's bodyguard. It was now dark. Escorted by his retinue, Germanus moved to the centre of the city, where he sought sanctuary in St. Sophia. News of his presence there must have spread quickly, for a crowd had gathered in the forecourt when a force of excubitors arrived to persuade him to leave the church. Whatever it was they had to say swayed Germanus. He was on his way out when he heard a loud shout from one of the clergy of St. Sophia, warning him that death lay in store for him. He turned back. At this, the crowd began to shout slogans against the emperor. The commotion grew. The members of the circus factions abandoned their stations on the Theodosian walls and joined in. The trouble spread out from St. Sophia and developed into a riot, in the course of which the house of the unpopular Praetorian prefect of the East, Constantine Lardis, was burned down. Maurice had lost control of the city at a critical moment, when the rebel army was close at hand. It was making a forced march that very night. Realising that his cause was doomed, Maurice, together with his immediate family, slipped away in the small hours before dawn on the 23rd of November. They were accompanied by Constantine Lardis and Theodosius's tutor, Stephen. Meanwhile, representatives of the Green faction also slipped out of the city and made contact with the rebel army, evidently to pledge Phocas their support. Inside the city, Germanus made a feeble bid for power, apparently with the backing of the Blues, of whom he was patron. He quickly abandoned it when his emissary to the Greens met with a rebuff because of his known connection with the Blues, and gave Phocas his support. Hence, Phocas encountered no resistance as he approached on the 23rd of November. At Rhegium on the Marmara coast, he was acclaimed by the Greens and formally invited to the military parade ground in the Hebdomen outside the city walls. He responded by sending an emissary to St. Sophia to issue a public invitation for the people, the Patriarch, and the Senate to attend on him. They met him in the Hebdomen, where the factions, acting as representatives of the people, raised him on a shield in the tribunal of the parade ground and acclaimed him emperor in the presence of the senators and the other spectators. This secular election was then followed by a ceremony in the church of St. John the Baptist nearby. First, the Patriarch Syriacus extracted a solemn declaration of Orthodox faith from Phocas, and an undertaking that he would leave the church undisturbed. Then Phocas made a show of reluctance by offering the throne to Germanus, which Germanus declined. Finally, the Patriarch crowned him. 2 days later, on Sunday, the 25th of November, Phocas made a ceremonial entry into the city, seated in a chariot and distributing gold as he went. Cheering crowds welcomed him as the procession came through the Golden Gate and went along the Messe to the palace. Races were then held to celebrate his accession. The celebrations continued on the following day. A donative was distributed among the troops. Phocas's wife, Leontia, was crowned Augusta, and more races were held in her honour. The fugitive imperial family did not evade the new ruler's grasp. The ship on which they were travelling was forced by contrary winds to put in at Diadromi, a port on the north side of the Gulf of Nicomedia. From there, Theodosius was sent off by land, accompanied by Constantine Lardis, to appeal to the Shah and Shah Khusro II for help. The emperor, with the rest of his family, his wife Constantina, his other 5 sons, Tiberius, Peter, Paul, Justin and Justinian, and his 3 daughters, Anastasia, Theoctiste and Cleopatra, continued his voyage, perhaps to put the pursuers off Theodosius's scent. but got no farther than Prinitus on the opposite shore of the Gulf of Nicomedia, where they stopped and sought sanctuary in the church of St. Autonomous because of the emperor's gout. There they were arrested and brought back to Chalcedon on the Asian shore of Bosporus opposite Constantinople to await their fate. It was determined by Phocas at the races celebrating Leontia's coronation as Augusta. He was spurred on to order a round of executions by a commotion which arose when the Blues would not give up their customary prime position to the Greens. In the course of it, shouts were heard coming from the Blues, referring to the fact that Morris was still alive. On the following day, Tuesday the 27th of November, Phocas commanded that Morris and his sons be executed. The order was carried out promptly in the harbour of Eutropius, outside Chalcedon. A semi-legendary story soon grew up, which gave a moving account of the occasion. Morris watched as four of his sons were beheaded. Then, when the nurse of the youngest, Justinian, substituted her own baby, he insisted that his own son be produced. And after all those present had lamented, when they saw milk as well as blood flow from the small corpse, he was beheaded himself. Four other executions were carried out, probably on the same day. Morris's unpopular Balkan generals, his brother Peter, who had fled with the imperial family and had probably been arrested with them, and Commentulus, executed near the church of St. Conon on the north shore of the Golden Horn, were singled out, presumably as a sop to the army which had brought Phocas to power. The other two were senior officers closely associated with the old regime, who may also have antagonised the Balkan troops, Peter's domesticus, Praesentinus, and the second in command to another of Morris's generals, his brother-in-law Philippicus. Other leading figures in Morris's regime who had been arrested were spared, including Philippicus and Germanus, who were allowed to retire and take holy orders the following year. A gruesome display of the severed heads of Morris and his five sons posted up on the military parade ground in the Hebdomen suburb conveyed vividly and unequivocally the news that the old regime had fallen to the army, to the population of the capital, and through them to the world at large. One head, though, was missing, that of Theodosius, Morris's eldest son. Speculation grew that he had been sent to get help from the Sasanian king Khusro II, and that he had succeeded in escaping. Official Roman sources, which are as usual reflected in the Chronicon Paschale's account, reported that he too had been caught and executed, together with Constantine Lardis, who was accompanying him. The place of their execution was named Diadromi, where they had been put ashore, but uncharacteristically, the chronicler was unable to supply a precise date. This suggests that it was not given in the bulletin which he was using. This official version failed to quell rumours that Theodosius was alive, and later that he had reached Persian territory and gained the support of the Shah and Shah for his claim to the imperial throne. Within the East Roman Empire, any suggestion that the son of the deposed and executed emperor was still alive and seeking to recover his throne was likely to increase disaffection at a time when the new regime was at its most vulnerable. Phocas's government denied categorically that Theodosius had escaped. The original version of his death was amended and elaborated. Theodosius had journeyed as far as Nicaea when he received an urgent summons to turn back from Morris, authenticated by a ring brought by the messenger. Dutifully he went back to face execution, which was now said to have taken place at St. Autonomous at the hands of Alexander, one of Phocas's two senior military allies. The official account is unlikely to have become more convincing with the addition of these rather implausible circumstantial details. A new and completely different version was also in circulation. It was admitted that Theodosius had got away, had reached the Black Sea, and had taken a ship to Lazica, planning to continue his journey overland. But it was claimed that he had died long before reaching Persian territory, either drowning during the voyage or collapsing as he travelled through desolate country beyond Lazica. John of Antioch noted the first of these stories, but refrained from giving it his assent, reporting merely that Theodosius escaped initially and avoided execution at Phocas's hands. Theophylact Simocata, writing in the 620s, noted the second story but rejected it, as any author who sought official patronage in Heraclius's reign would have had to. Public opinion, however, was probably still not won over, since there was still a glaring absence of proof that Theodosius had been executed, and changes in the official line cast doubt on the truth of all the versions peddled. 1.2. Persian preparations for war. The news of the revolution in Constantinople reached Khusro II, probably in his capital, Ctesiphon. He may have been genuinely saddened at the overthrow and murder of his benefactor Maurice. The arrival of Theodosius, if he did succeed in reaching Persia, may have aroused pity and a determination to wreak vengeance on the usurper. But apart from any moral or personal considerations, the opportunity was too good to miss. He decided to replay the events of 590 to 591, this time with the Persians intervening to restore the legitimate ruler, or a claimant masquerading as such, to the rival partner empire of the Romans. The reward would be the recovery of the territory which Maurice had demanded as the price for his military and political support. The fall of Maurice provided the best possible pretext for going to war. The timing was also miraculously fortunate from the Persian point of view, for Khusro had been preoccupied hitherto by other pressing political and military concerns. His restoration in 591 had not ended civil strife within Persia. The opposition, which was led by his uncle Bistam, had come out in open rebellion in 595 to 596. Defeat in battle had forced Bistam out of the open country of Media into the fastnesses of the Elburz Mountains to the north. But he remained for many years a formidable foe, backed as he was by Daylamite Highlanders and a disgruntled court party. He strengthened his position, winning over regular troops from his home region of Komis and an Armenian force stationed at Isfahan, and gaining control of the whole length of the Elburz range. He thereby extended his reach perilously close to the northeastern frontier, where it abutted onto the transcontinental empire of the Turks. At the same time, there was no relaxation of the pressure which the Turks could apply on the outer defences of the sown lands of Persia in the 590s. The bulk of Khusro's field forces, which included an important Armenian component, were therefore committed to a long, demanding defensive war in the north and northeast. In 601 to 602, though, both the domestic and foreign problems were solved. Sumbat Bagratuni, an Armenian general much lauded among his countrymen, crushed the last remnants of Bistam's rebel forces, while the Turks, apart from the perennial distraction of succession crises, were drawn east to intervene in China in those very years. By the end of 602, it was clear that there was an opportunity to set about redressing the strategic balance so unfavourable to Persia. Cession of the eastern third of the Armenian Taurus had given the Romans control over the whole range from the Euphrates Gorges in the west to Lake Van in the east, and over all three strategic passes across the mountains. This brought with it a decisive advantage of inner lines, for command of all the passes and their denial to the enemy would, at times of war, enable the Romans to transfer troops between the Armenian and Mesopotamian theatres of war with a speed which could not be matched by the Persians, using the circuitous and more difficult passes across the Zagros, well to the rear of the frontier. The resulting superior capacity of the Romans to mobilise and concentrate their military resources, whether for defensive or offensive purposes, was in danger of relegating Persia to the status of an inferior power. No Shahanshah could ignore the chance of altering arrangements which amounted to the military castration of Persia in the west. The territorial adjustments made in Armenia and Iberia were militarily of less significance, but were likely to inflict considerable political damage in the longer term. For it was the steady encroachment of Roman power and influence which posed the greatest threat to the security of the Sasanian Empire. Since its first appearance in these northern lands, Christianity had acted as a corrosive agent, breaking down the traditional cultural connections between the local nobilities of the region and those of the Iranian plateau and its fringing mountains. Behind the advance of the new faith, Roman authority had been pushed outwards, step by step, towards the main Persian dependencies in Transcaucasia. The definitive annexation of Lazica, agreed under the terms of the 562 treaty, was a serious setback. Further damage was done to Persian interests by the territorial concessions extracted from Khusro II in 590. Roman rule was extended deep into two of Persia's three northwestern dependencies. Both Persarmenia and Iberia lost their western territories. The two provincial capitals, Divin and Tiflis, were left exposed, perilously close to the new frontier. Beyond, the open valleys of the Araxes and Kura rivers led into the plains of Albania, the third dependency, and Atropatene, the westernmost region in the Persian heartlands. Khusro had little choice but to go to war, with the aim of recovering some or all of the lost territories, and thus improving the security of Iran. Had he failed to act in 603 or very soon afterwards, his position would assuredly have come under threat at home. Finally, Khusro cannot have been unaffected by a general souring of relations between the two great powers. That sense of shared interest in the face of the outer peoples, of being engaged in a common endeavour of protecting the civilised world from attack by northern barbarians, had been destroyed, or at any rate seriously weakened in the course of the 6th century. Successive acts of aggression by each side shook the faith of the other in the existing world order. Each round of warfare thickened the atmosphere of suspicion and fear left by the previous one. Justin II's decision to ally with the Turks, whereby the Roman Empire abandoned its old commitment to coexistence, administered the coup de grace. Beneath the superficial restoration of the old order, brought about when Morris agreed to give Khusro his political and military support, old resentments festered and new wrongs demanded to be righted. Considerations such as these impelled Khusro to seize the extraordinary opportunity proffered in the winter of 602 to 603. He instituted a period of national mourning for the death of Morris and insisted on its ostentatious observance by the army, thereby preparing public opinion for war. He gave orders for the mobilization of Persian forces. A northern army was to move forward and take up winter quarters at Divin, capital of Persarmenia. There it was placed close to the Roman frontier, ready to invade in the following spring. To the south of the Armenian Taurus in Mesopotamia, Khusro probably supervised preparations himself, since he took personal command when operations began. There too, Persian forces were probably concentrated close to the frontier in Nisibis, the main forward base. Finally, either Theodosius or a convincing impostor was produced, and portrayed in Persian propaganda as the rightful ruler of the Roman Empire, thus softening up the exposed frontier provinces before the start of offensive operations. News of Morris's overthrow was received calmly in most Roman provinces. There was no disturbance in Egypt. Some advance intelligence came from a calligrapher who had dined well at a merchant's house. His informants were statues, which he claimed descended stealthily from their pedestals and accosted him as he made his way home in the small hours. They gave him the hot news 9 days before the arrival of official confirmation. Simokata, the source for this story, was probably well informed about conditions in the province, since the Augustalis, governor at the time, was a relative of his. Armenia, too, did not stir. Disenchantment with Morris's military and ecclesiastical policies had a delayed effect, which only showed itself in 605 in the form of fraying loyalty in the high command. The only recorded reaction among Armenian leaders to the news of Morris's death at the time was on the part of Atat Korkoruni, the bold commander who had attempted to rouse armed insurrection against Morris in 601. He now planned to slip away from the Persian court at Ctesiphon and to offer his services to the new Roman emperor, but his plan was discovered and he was executed on Khusro's orders. Events in Syria and northern Mesopotamia, however, did provide Khusro with some encouragement. Narses, commander-in-chief of the armies of Oriens, the Levant, a distinguished general of Maurice's, refused to recognise the usurper, left Antioch when news of the putsch reached him, and seized Edessa. Edessa was a powerfully defended city in the heavily militarised forward zone on the far bank of the Euphrates. As such, it could act as a secure base for his rebel forces. It was also within striking distance of the Persian frontier, giving Narses the option of calling on the Persians for assistance. This he proceeded to do, writing to Khusro and inviting him to assemble his forces and make war upon the Romans. Khusro now had formal, legal justification for intervening in the internal affairs of the Roman Empire. The prospects of military success were also greatly enhanced, since the rebels would be able to disrupt the mobilisation of Roman forces and any efforts they made to reinforce the defences of the principal cities and bases close to the frontier, Dara, Theodosiopolis, Constantia and Amida. The new government of Phocas moved fast to snuff out the rebellion. Germanus, a senior regional commander, to be distinguished from Theodosius, his father-in-law, who was in Constantinople, was ordered to move against Narses. It was probably well before the start of spring and the completion of Persian preparations for war that Germanus's forces dug themselves in round Edessa and began siege operations. Narses, however, remained quiet inside the city, confident that the Persians would send assistance before long and that the fortifications would keep the besiegers at bay in the meantime. The revolt was a serious challenge to Phocas's regime. For the moment, the trouble was contained, and the prospects of suppressing it in the near future looked good until news came of Persian military preparations. There was no sense of urgency initially, as Phocas prepared to dispatch an embassy to inform Khusro of his accession, in accordance with the tradition which required each great power to communicate with the other on such occasions. Several months passed before the ambassador Lilius set off in March 603, travelling along the main diagonal road across Asia Minor, then through the Mesopotamian military zone to Dara, where he was entertained by Germanus. From Dara, he crossed the frontier and proceeded to the royal court at Ctesiphon. His reception there was anything but welcoming. The Persians refused to recognise the new regime and sent back a blunt note expressing Khusro's regard for Maurice and declaring war. Lilius was detained at Ctesiphon, where he remained, apparently, until his death. By this act, which flouted the conventions governing diplomatic exchanges, Khusro made yet plainer his determination to dispose of the upstart emperor who had ousted and murdered his benefactor.
1.3. Opening Campaigns. Several months were spent in preparations for the Persian offensive before attacks in force were launched across the frontier, both in the north, into that part of Persarmenia which had been annexed by the Romans in 591, and into the forward defensive zone in northern Mesopotamia, south of the Armenian Taurus. Zuan Vei, who had spent the winter in Devine, faced a substantial Roman force, which had taken up a position very close to the frontier at Elivard. Elivard, a small town, Kalakagil, Komopolis, lay some 50 kilometres from Devine, midway between two northern tributaries of the Araxes. There, the Roman troops were well placed to counter a Persian attempt to invade along the obvious easy route up the Araxes Valley, either by swooping down against its northern flank or by making a diversionary attack on the exposed plain of Devine in its rear. Zuan Vei, however, did not take the easy line of advance, but turned north to engage the Romans in the plain of Elivard. He was defeated in the ensuing battle. The Persians suffered heavy losses, including Zuan Vei himself, who was killed. Their camp was captured and rich booty gathered from inside it. The sector of the plain bordering the river was called Meadow of the Romans. This northern campaign was, however, as much a diversionary action designed to detain the regional Roman field army in the Armenian theatre as an attempt to win a victory or gain territory there or influence Armenian opinion. for it was essential for the Persians to secure the southern invasion army from the danger of a flank attack launched across one of the three main Armenian Taurus passes. Despite the disastrous end of the campaign, this purpose was achieved. No threatening moves from the north distracted the Persian forces in Mesopotamia from their objectives. Khusro took personal charge of operations in the south, a sign of the greater importance attached to them. Germanus was in a relatively weak position, caught between the besieged rebel forces in Edessa and a Persian field army bearing down on him from the southeast. He retreated towards the Euphrates, apparently taking the road north to Samosata rather than the main road west towards the crossing at Zeugma, and hoping thereby to avoid combat with Khusro's army. Khusro, meanwhile, marched against Dara without encountering serious resistance. Leaving a general there to organise siege operations, he advanced deeper into Roman territory, seeking to bring Germanus to battle. This he did, catching the Roman army on the nearer left bank of the Euphrates and winning a decisive victory. Germanus was mortally wounded and taken off by his bodyguards to Constantia, the nearest secure Roman base, where he died 11 days later. Khusro could now proceed at his leisure to Edessa. The main gate of the city was opened when he arrived. This was the first Roman city entered by the Persians in the course of the war. It provided the setting for the assertion of the claims of the pretender Theodosius before a Roman audience. A full coronation ceremony was laid on. It was carefully stage-managed to maximise its impact on those present and on public opinion elsewhere. The leading role was assigned to Narses, the general who had demonstrated his devotion to Maurice and his family by his open opposition to the new regime. After the young man, who wore imperial robes, was crowned, Narses formally placed him under the protection of the Shah and Shah, asking him to show the same compassion as he had been shown by Maurice. The ceremony made a considerable impression, despite strenuous efforts by Phocas's government to discredit the pretender and to portray the whole event as Narses' idea. It is impossible for us to be certain whether or not the pretender was Maurice's son. Too much obfuscation has been cast by the propaganda spewed out by both great powers in the opening engagements of the war. Was he a stooge of Khusro's, who was brought in state by the Persian army and introduced by Khusro to Narses at Edessa? Was he an impostor, whom Narses presented to Khusro on the occasion of his visit to Edessa? Or were his claims genuine? Was he the Theodosius, whose birth on the 4th of August 583 was celebrated by Evagrius in an encomium? Was it to him that the future Pope Gregory the Great stood godfather when he was baptised at Epiphany 584, an occasion commemorated by massive 12 solidi gold medallions distributed by the Emperor Maurice? Was it the young man destined to reign as Theodosius III who was crowned in a solemn ceremony at Edessa in the presence of the Shah and Shah? Whatever the truth, the coronation and the formal public appeal for Persian aid issued by Narses had the desired effect. There can be little doubt that it undermined, to a significant extent, the will to resist of the frontier provinces, and thus helped the Persians to break through the forward defences and to reach the Euphrates by 610. Clear, direct evidence of this came a few years later in 607 at Theodosiopolis, on the edge of the Roman sector of Armenia. The city capitulated promptly after a deputation met Theodosius and was convinced of his identity. In Constantinople, the key surviving members of Theodosius's family, his mother, three sisters, wife, and father-in-law Germanus, are reported to have believed that he was the pretender sponsored by Khusro, and to have taken part in a broad-based but unsuccessful conspiracy to dethrone Phocas in 604 to 605. For this they paid with their lives. After the ceremony at Edessa, Khusro concentrated on the siege of Dara, establishing his headquarters at Nisibis, just across the frontier. Narses seems to have been left to carry on defending Edessa with his own forces against whatever new armies the emperor might send against him. The presence of a Persian field army within striking distance was likely to deter all but the most formidable of armies from renewing the siege. In the event, Phocas was able to deploy a large relieving force in the 604 campaigning season after negotiating a new treaty with the Avars, with a substantial increase in the cash subvention, which freed up large numbers of Balkan troops for service in the east. A similar treaty agreed with the Lombards a year later ensured that there would be no distractions from the west for more than a decade. Khusraw was prevented from repeating the tactics of 603 when the commanding general Leontius, a eunuch, followed Phocas's orders and divided his army, sending half towards Dara to mask his own attack on Edessa. This risky move paid off at first. Narses was unable to hold out in Edessa and fled to Hierapolis. But Khusraw was able to engage the other force as it approached Dara. This second battle, fought on the Arzamon River, modern Zergansu, which flows south from the Tur Abdin plateau to the Kabur River, a few kilometres west of Dara, resulted in a crushing victory, with large numbers of Roman troops taken prisoner. The strategic initiative had been regained and would not be relinquished for many years to come. Khusraw could delegate the rest of the siege to a subordinate, now that Dara's fate was sealed, and return triumphant to his capital. On the Roman side, Leontius was dismissed and replaced by the emperor's nephew Domitiolus, who persuaded Narses to give himself up with the promise of a fair trial, although what awaited him on arrival in Constantinople was death at the stake. Dara continued to hold out, but eventually, after a year and a half, the powerful defences of this hardest of hardpoint fortresses succumbed to Persian mining operations. The news from the northern Armenian front was also encouraging. The defeat of 603 was avenged in the 604 campaigning season. Doubtless larger forces were deployed. The account, in the history of Khosrov, is rather fuller than that of 603, perhaps reflecting the balance of an official Sasanian source which was inclined to elaborate on success rather than failure. In the course of the narrative, it becomes plain that the strains engendered by internal conflict within the Roman Empire were affecting army morale in 604, and that by 605 there was disaffection on the part of the Armenian element in its high command and in the ranks, a first manifestation, perhaps, of disenchantment with Roman rule generated by Maurice's military and, to a lesser extent, religious policies. The Persian invasion force was commanded by a certain Datoyan in 604. The Romans were encamped at the village of Shirakavan on the eastern edge of Vanand, the Kars plain. As in 603, they were holding the line of a major tributary of the Araxes, this time the Arcurian, which flows from north to south, farther back in Roman territory, to the northwest rather than the south of Mount Aragats. No explanation is given for this withdrawal deeper into Roman territory. Unreported Persian raids or forays may have preceded the main attack and forced the Romans back, or it may have been a deliberate tactical retreat to a stronger position. Shirakavan commanded the only easy ford over the Arcurian, in the face of a more powerful enemy. If the latter was the case, it was a move which failed. For the Romans were surprised by the speed of the Persian advance and hurriedly withdrew across the river to a new position a few kilometres to the northwest at the village of Getik near the fortress of Ergine. The fortress was packed with refugees from 33 villages. The Persians followed and launched an attack. Although the able-bodied young men among the refugees inside the fortress sallied out in force and inflicted considerable losses on them, the Persians were not distracted from their main task. They engaged the Roman army, put it to flight, and pursued the fugitives, slaughtering all whom they caught. After gathering the booty and returning to their camp, they turned their attention to Ergine. Mounting a full-scale assault, they stormed it and captured the refugees inside. No attempt was made to garrison Ergine and turn it into a Persian bridgehead on the edge of the plain of Kars, nor even to hold the territory farther east, which the Romans had not defended in 604. Instead, the victorious Persian army withdrew to its base in Atropatene with its rich haul of prisoners and booty. The defeat of 603 had been avenged, Persian prestige had been restored. The Persians concentrated on the Armenian front in 605. There is no report of fighting in Mesopotamia. They seem to have been content to consolidate their position in and around Dara, ready to defend the city if the Roman field army made an effort to recover it. Since the military initiative lay with them, this pause must reflect a deliberate change of strategy on their part. The forces in the south were being given a secondary supporting role, that of detaining the main body of Roman troops and preventing them intervening north of the Taurus. It is tempting with hindsight to suggest that political considerations also exercised some influence, for it was in 604 to 605 that a broad alliance of dissident elements in the governing circles of Constantinople set about organizing a counter-coup against Phocas. In Armenia, too, treason was in the air, and in the event, acting in apparent collusion with the Persian forces, Armenians serving with the Roman field army ensured that it suffered a second serious defeat in open battle. It would not have been unreasonable for the Persians to suppose that the shock of a double defeat in the east might weaken the position of Phocas's government and prepare the ground for a counter-coup. They might also have hoped that discontent, either in the army, evidently fighting a losing war, or in the rich provinces of the Levant and Asia Minor, which would be exposed if the forward defensive zone in Mesopotamia suffered further serious damage, would lead to a second and more dangerous uprising in support of the Persian-backed pretender. Khusraw, from his vantage point in Ctesiphon, may therefore have decided on relative inaction in the southern theatre, biding his time and waiting on events which ought to favour the Persian cause and might enable victory to be achieved without several more years of wearing conflict. Sinitam Khusraw was appointed Spahbed, regional military commander of the West, and took over the supreme command relinquished by the Shahanshah after the fall of Dara. His presence in Armenia is a sure indication of the priority accorded to operations there. Aware that the Romans would expect him to renew the offensive on the easiest sector of the front, the upper Araxes Valley and the relatively open country to the north, where the flattened mass of the Aragats volcano leads into the upland plain of Kars, he chose instead to attack south of Mount Ararat, crossing an easy pass and descending into the elongated plain of Bagrevand, where the Arsanias River gathers its headwaters. A Roman force was stationed in the eastern sector of the plain, where it was well placed both to march north and attack the Persians in the rear if they advanced up the Araxes, and to bar access to the Arsanias Valley. It included a considerable number of Armenian troops. The commanding general was also Armenian, Theodos Korkoruni. He had created a well-fortified encampment at a village close to the Arsanias, demolishing a second village on the opposite bank, presumably to prevent the Persian army from taking it over. From this strong defensive position, as well as the large fortress of Angul nearby, which he garrisoned, he would be able to send out harassing forays or to strike in greater force against the Persian army, confident in the strength of the two mutually supporting positions. Senitam Khusraw succeeded in circling round and establishing a camp of his own to the rear of the Romans. The Romans were offered an opportunity to withdraw before they decided, after some hesitation, to stay put and fight. A dawn attack then achieved complete surprise. Continuous arrow fire by massed archers caused mayhem in the Roman camp, where both men unarmed and mounts, tethered by the tents, were exposed. The wounded horses broke free and trampled over the tents and other parts of the camp. Confusion was compounded by the actions of the retainers of the Armenian princes serving in the army. They attacked the soldiers as they armed themselves and cut the girths of the horses as they were being saddled. In all the confusion, the Persians were able to breach the fortified perimeter and pour into the camp. The defenders then made their own breach and took flight on foot and horseback, apart from the many who had been caught and killed. There does not seem to have been a pursuit. The Persians stayed in the Roman camp overnight, and the next day sent a note demanding the evacuation of the Roman garrison from Angul. The Romans duly departed within the 3 days which had been stipulated, taking their baggage and equipment with them, while Theodos Corcoruni was detained and sent to Cusro with a recommendation that he be treated well. Whether he really had helped the Persians, as was publicly stated, or the story was a piece of black propaganda issued to encourage disaffection among the Armenian nobility, is an unanswerable question. Senitam Khusro then resumed his advance. His route took him across Bagrevand, north over the mountains and into the Araxes Valley, well to the west of the farthest point reached in 604. In the great plain of Bassian, he met a second, probably larger Roman army, won a second victory and threw the Romans back across the pre-591 frontier on the Araxes-Euphrates watershed. The campaign narrative ends with a list of the chief gains of the year, here all classified as cities. 3 in Armenia: Angel, a local commander, was installed, Gelatuk, commanding a strategic pass on the Bagrevand-Bassian route taken by Senitam Khusro, and Ergine in Vanand, which was presumably now garrisoned a year after its initial capture in 604, and one in the Mesopotamian theatre, Tsnakert, near Dara. At the end of the campaigning season, Senitam Khusro received orders to withdraw to Persian territory. The achievements of the year were considerable. Roman authority had been peeled off the territories ceded in a moment of extraordinary political weakness at the start of Khusro's reign. The advantage of inner lines given by control of the central Armenian lands, as well as all 3 Armenian Taurus passes, had been seized from the Romans. Senitam Khusro had complimented the successes achieved south of the Armenian Taurus, where Khusro had, by the capture of Dara, made the first vital breach in the outer defences of Mesopotamia, and, no less important, had shaken the confidence of the great adversary of Sasanian Persia. Much, of course, remained to be done in both theatres of war if Khusro's intention was to force an equitable peace treaty out of the Romans and to impose his own candidate on them. The systems of defence elaborated by the Roman military authorities, at great cost to the imperial exchequer over many generations, would now have to be assaulted in a laborious, slow-moving, unrelenting offensive, the strategic equivalent of street fighting, which would put great strain on Persian resources and morale. It would be a war of attrition, chipping away at key points in the nexus of Roman fortifications. A decisive superiority in manpower and materiel would be needed, together with steely determination. Khusro therefore ordered a halt to the advance in 606. A year's breathing space would allow his forces in both theatres to recuperate, and would enable him to institute a recruiting drive throughout his empire. 1.4. Second Persian Offensive. No major operations are recorded for 606. The Persians were preparing the ground for a second offensive on a grander scale, almost certainly with a barrage of propaganda supporting the claims of the pretender and denouncing the regime of Phocas. Hitherto, they had responded to events with the resources to hand, exploiting the opportunities offered in both theatres by the open rebellion of Narses and the covert treachery of Theodos Corcoruni. They had made substantial gains, but they still faced powerful Roman armies, which could be expected to put up a stubborn fight. The main purpose of the year's pause was to enlist and train the additional troops required to negate the marginal advantage enjoyed by the Romans, for they still controlled the most direct lines of north-south communication, both within Armenia, linking the Euphrates and Arsanias valleys, and between the Armenian and Mesopotamian fronts. The strategy which was adopted and implemented in 607 involved major attacks on both fronts. The 2 Roman regional armies were to be engaged on a large enough scale to prevent troop transfers between fronts, save for those dictated by the Persians so as to draw off reserves before decisive blows were struck. Each attack marked the first step in an offensive which would be sustained for several campaigning seasons. The Armenian History of Khosrov, the best source for operations in this first phase of the war, gives summary accounts of the main stages of the Persian advance to 610, when a second temporary halt seems to have been called. The narrative of events is consolidated into two separate notices, dealing respectively with the southern and northern fronts. Meagre information is supplied about operations in the south. They were marginal to the history of Armenia. It is fortunate that the history's account can be supplemented by a number of notices in Syrian sources, of which the most trustworthy is the Chronicle to 724. Patchy though the coverage is, it is evident that the Persian advance was painfully slow to begin with, and that it only gathered momentum in 609. This is at odds with the impression given by the telescoping of several campaigns into the history's single notice that the conquest was easy and rapid. Coriam Erasman, Spachbed of the East, was brought west, presumably with a body of troops, and given the southern command. His orders were to invade Roman Mesopotamia and to treat well all those who submitted voluntarily. A certain amount of wishful thinking lay behind the second of these orders. There is no evidence that the provincials, despite their adherence to the Monophysite confession, were ready to collaborate with the invaders. Instead, Coriam had to fight hard to achieve his first objective, the conquest of the Tur Abdin Massif. Then, and only then, was there a perceptible faltering in the resistance put up by Roman troops and civilians. The start of Coriam's operations is reported before the renewal of action on the Armenian front, which is dated to the 18th year of Khusro's reign, June 607 to June 608. If the southern offensive was intended to draw reserves away from the northern theatre, it was launched between 1 and 2 months earlier, probably in late spring or early summer 607. The Tur Abdin had to be the Persians' first objective, since it formed a heavily defended outer bastion in the complex nexus of fortifications of Mesopotamia. As long as the forts, with which Anastasius and his immediate successor Justin I had endowed the Tur Abdin hills, remained in Roman hands, any gains made by the Persians in the upper Tigris basin to the north or immediately to the south and southwest would be threatened, as would be their lines of supply. Coriam, therefore, concentrated his forces against the Tur Abdin. His principal target was Kiffa, which controlled a strategic bridge over the Tigris and guarded the approaches to the northeast end of the Tur Abdin. Stubborn resistance by the garrison assuredly encouraged the defenders elsewhere. The fall of Kiffa, on the eve of a particularly severe winter in 608 to 609, triggered a first strategic withdrawal by Roman forces. They evacuated all the forts which they still held and fell back on the great fortresses of the plains and the inner defensive line on the Euphrates. Not that this was the end of resistance in the Tur Abdin. At Mardin, civilians continued the fight after the departure of Roman regulars. Monophysite monks joined in, after asking for and probably obtaining their bishop's permission to take up arms. However frayed their political loyalty to the East Roman regime, however deep their resentment of the authorities' repeated attempts to repress or at least contain Monophysitism in the eastern provinces, there was no question of their abandoning the struggle when the enemy was the dualist Persian state, which harboured within it the Nestorians, the most hated of all the Monophysites' rivals among the Christian sects. The monks are portrayed as taking a leading role in the defence of the city, in effect as shock troops of Christendom in battle with the agents of the devil. They kept up the resistance for an appreciable time, 6 months or so, probably until early spring 609. It was only then, when Mardin fell, that the Persians were able to occupy the whole of the Tur Abdin and to inaugurate the second phase of their offensive. They now brought intense pressure to bear on the main Roman cities of Mesopotamia, which could, with their powerful fortifications, double as major military bases and formed the nodal points of the regional defensive system. The first to yield was not among those most exposed to Persian attack, for it was Edessa, lying a considerable distance to the southwest of Amida, the great Roman redoubt in the rich, rolling plains of the upper Tigris, and well to the rear of the chief military centres of the lands fringing the desert to the south and southwest of the Tur Abdin. Edessa capitulated in summer 609, and in so doing fatally undermined the defence of the forward military zone. For the main cities, which remained in Roman hands, were now cut off from the interior of the empire, since Edessa commanded the routes leading to them from Roman positions on the Euphrates. Their fate sealed, Amida surrendered, together with the southern Theodosiopolis, formerly Resina, and Constantia, which had probably resumed their old 4th and 5th century roles as the two main forward bases of the Romans south of the Tur Abdin after the loss of Dara. Persian power was now coming close to the Romans' last effective line of defence, the Euphrates Limes, dating from the Principate. Carai, lying to the south of Edessa, where the cultivable plain of Osrini shades into semi-desert, now felt the full force of Persian military power. So too did the two main Roman bases on the east bank of the Euphrates, Circesium near the traditional frontier and Callinicum due south of Carai, both of which had been linchpins of the defensive system, designed both to impede Persian advance up the Euphrates valley and to control the Bedouin of the northwest desert since its development by Diocletian. They were all in Persian hands before the end of the campaigning season. The following winter, 609-610, the Euphrates was the frontier between the two empires. The patient strategy of Coriam had gradually worn down the material defences of Mesopotamia and eroded the resolve of the Roman forces deployed there. The conquest of the whole region, thereby depriving the rich provinces beyond of their apparently impregnable shield, was a signal military achievement. It was only outshone by the first ferocious attacks on the Roman Empire of Shapur I in the initial dynamic expansion of Sasanian power in the 3rd century. It was surely in recognition of these services that Khusro designated Coriam Sharbaraz Panther of the Realm. The Persians waited on events in 610. The long-expected revolution was gathering momentum inside the East Roman Empire. Sharbaraz contented himself that summer with a single operation of significance, an attack across the Euphrates at the southern end of the front. With his capture of Zenobia, which fell on the 7th of August, he secured a bridgehead midway between Circesium and Callinicum from which to launch attacks deep into Syria. He also succeeded in distracting the attention of the Roman defenders from what was almost certainly his main objective that year, the Euphrates crossing much farther upstream on the direct road to Antioch. In the north, two decisive victories in the field opened the way for a sequence of wide-ranging campaigns, which brought the Persians to the Anatolian plateau by 611 and enabled them to impose their authority on much of Roman Armenia. The first of these victories was won by Astat Yeztayar in 607 over a Roman army which was counterattacking towards Bassian, the westernmost district occupied by the Persians. Astat and his expeditionary force were intercepted at Du and Ordru, just below the watershed between the Euphrates and Araxes catchment areas. The ensuing battle ended in bloody defeat for the Romans. The fleeing remnants of their army were pursued as far as Satala in northeast Anatolia, while the main body of the Persians advanced without encountering further opposition over the pass and closed in on Theodosiopolis. Theodosiopolis was the key military base in this northern sector of Roman Armenia. Since the beginning of the 5th century, it had been both the chief city of the region, from which Roman influence gradually percolated into the surrounding highlands, and had housed the garrison, which secured the eastern end of the natural invasion route formed by the upper Euphrates Valley. The siege did not go well at first. The Roman defenders put up stout resistance and inflicted considerable losses. Astat then decided to deploy his secret weapon, the pretender Theodosius, who had been assigned to the northern theatre for this first year of the second Persian offensive. He was brought up to the front line. A deputation of dignitaries from the city was invited to meet him. The audience with him convinced them that he was Maurice's son, and on their return to the city they convinced their fellow citizens. The gates were opened. The city formally submitted. Astat thus gained a great prize at minimal expense, thanks to the psychological impact of the apparently legitimate pretender's claims on his adversaries. He left a garrison in the city, doubtless a very powerful one, given the strategic importance of Theodosiopolis, and continued operations. These operations are best construed as consisting of distinct raids carried out by separate forays deep into Roman territory. Astat's role was presumably to direct and coordinate from the rear the actions of the independent detachments which he sent ahead. One foray was dispatched before the capitulation of Theodosiopolis, immediately after the battle. Its original task was to pursue the routed Roman forces as they fled west, but after a time, the nature of the operation changed. What had begun as an urgent pursuit turned into a deep penetrating raid along the Romans' main northern support road, which took this foray into the northeast corner of the Anatolian plateau. There, two Roman bases, Satala and Nicopolis, which dated from the Principate and acted as major buttresses of the northern sector of the Euphrates Limes, came under attack. Another foray operated south of the northern support road, entering the fertile plain of Derjan, modern Erzincan, a region of especial importance in Armenian eyes, into which the Roman military authorities had refrained from intruding. The chief centre of the region, Eriza, was attacked. A third foray raided far to the southwest, advancing beyond the plain of Taron, where the Persians had established a presence in 605, into the district of Asthianini, which was still in Roman hands. Asthianini was the next large plain in the Arsanias Valley downstream from Taron, and commanded the northern approach to the easiest central pass over the Armenian Taurus. The Persians' objective there was the fortress of Kitarizon, which had been built in the early 6th century with the triple function of securing the northern access to the pass, controlling the southern invasion route along the Arsanias Valley, and intensifying Roman authority over the hill country to the north. All three forays were successful. The history of Khosrov reports that all four of the named places which they attacked were taken, but makes no mention of their being garrisoned. It seems safe to infer from this silence that no attempt was made to occupy them and turn them into forward bases for harassing the surrounding areas, but that as winter drew near, the forays returned to the main army under Astat's command. The whole army then withdrew to Persian-held territory. The fall of Theodosiopolis was a serious blow to the Romans and must have lowered Roman prestige throughout Armenia, as well as depressing morale and increasing dissidence in the other provinces of the east. The subsequent raids extended the material and psychological damage and were an earnest of what the northern Persian command had in store for the land north of the Taurus in the near future. They may also have set a pattern which was to be followed in the operations of the next few years, a main Persian force advancing in good order to deal with major centres of population behind a screen of raiding forays. Despite these striking achievements, Astat was replaced by a new general. Shahen Patgosapan, who was to have an extraordinarily distinguished career in Khosrow's service, now, spring 608 presumably, made his first appearance on the historical stage. He marched across the Araxes-Euphrates watershed into the district of Theodosiopolis, bypassing the city itself, and engaged the latest and last effective fighting force fielded by the Romans in Armenia. He won a decisive victory and drove the defeated Roman troops out of the country. Roman defence of their lands east of the Euphrates seems now to have collapsed. At his leisure in the following campaigning season, Shahen advanced westwards across Armenia. The start of operations is dated to the 20th year of Khosrow's reign, June 609 to June 610. No details are given about specific actions in 609 to 610, probably because there were no notable battles to record, but by the winter of 610 to 611, Shahen's forces had reached the Romans' inner line of defence on the Euphrates, where the river turns south and forces its way against the grain of the relief towards the Taurus and beyond Syria and Mesopotamia. for he was able, in spring 611, to strike deep into Anatolia and to seize the city of Caesarea in Cappadocia. Doubtless, Shahen's advance along the two great river valleys, which provide relatively easy access to eastern Anatolia, was slowed by local pockets of Roman resistance and by the organisational task of setting up local military administrations. But his principal concern in these 2 years was probably to get a firm military grip on the mountainous spine of western Armenia separating the river valleys, and to establish a degree of Persian authority on the outer fringes of the formidable highland regions flanking this central Armenian causeway. For it was essential to discourage the highlanders from resorting to insurgency tactics, which would very rapidly affect Persian communications and the security of smaller, isolated outposts, by a formidable display of military might right at the start of the period of Persian occupation. The process of pacification would be a long and laborious one, and it had to be initiated on a grand scale in these years. It is, however, almost entirely concealed from our gaze, save for one dramatic episode. This involved the deportation of population from Theodosiopolis, the chief city of Roman Armenia, to Hamadan, the chief city of Media. It was ordered by Khusro himself in 610 to 611, the year in which the initial conquest of Roman Armenia was completed. It was presumably a security measure designed to remove dissident elements from the city, notably the Roman-sponsored Chalcedonian Catholicos, John. He was deported along with all the treasure of his Catholicosate, which included a great deal of plate purloined not long before from the Monophysite Catholicosate. Much of the foregoing reconstruction is speculative, but fixed chronological points are supplied by the history of Khosrov, which leaves little doubt about the main stages of Shahen's western advance in the northern theatre of war. First, there was his decisive victory in the field in 608, which followed up that won by Astat Yestayar in the previous year. Then a phase lasting 2 years, in which his forces overran and occupied western Armenia, and finally, in 611, the first major breach in the northern sector of the Romans' Euphrates Limes. The Emperor Phocas, 602 to 610, has been given a bad press. His image is that of a tyrant at home who disposed ruthlessly of opponents and a disastrous war leader abroad. Hard-fought campaigns dissolve into swift Persian advances, in the course of which successive chunks of Roman territory are taken, and city after city falls into enemy hands. The Persians not only break through the Romans' inner defences by the end of his reign, but push on through the Levant to Egypt and cross Asia Minor to the Bosporus. In the Balkans too, the Roman position collapses as the Avars are reactivated and ravage widely. Such was the record of his reign current a century or so later, when Theophilus of Edessa, at work in the Caliphate, was piecing together a history of the demise of the ancient world and the rise of Islam. It was picked up from him half a century or so later and recycled by the Byzantine historian Theophanes. In reality, Phocas was a more than competent general. It is hard otherwise to explain his election by officers and men of the Balkan Expeditionary Force as their leader, or the intelligence displayed in his seizure of power. As emperor, he faced grave problems. The troops who had brought him to power were weary of fighting. The Avars, temporarily disabled by defeat, must be cajoled into agreeing to make peace on terms which would secure the gains made by the Romans in recent years, but which were attractive enough to ensure their quiescence for the foreseeable future. In the east, war loomed, and the Roman position was fatally weakened by the rebellion of Narses, commander-in-chief in the Levant. The response of the new regime was swift and effective. Loyal troops were mobilised to isolate and besiege Narses in Edessa. By the middle of summer 603, when the Persians attacked in force, the field armies of Oriens and Armenia were ready to meet them in open battle. The prospect for the southern commander Germanus was grim, caught as he was between a rebel to his rear and a full Persian invasion force ahead. The opening battle went against him, but the Romans managed to strengthen their position over the following year or so, while Khusraw concentrated on the siege of Dara. Narses was driven from Edessa and forced to surrender. Dara eventually fell, but the rest of the forward defensive system, the network of fortified places which turned the Tur Abdin into a massive redoubt, the great city of Amida to the north, and the three well-defended cities behind Dara, Theodosiopolis, Resina, Constantia and Edessa, was activated and ready to withstand assault. North of the Armenian Taurus, an unnamed general inflicted a serious defeat on the invading army. It took another 2 years of hard campaigning for the Persians to redress the balance and to push forward to the old pre-591 frontier in Armenia. For 3 years, 603 to 605, Phocas thus succeeded in stemming the Persian advance. Of the strongholds lying inside the traditional boundaries of the empire, only Dara had fallen. Otherwise, the defensive system built up over many centuries and completed in the 6th century was intact. His real coup, though, took place in the Balkans and Italy, where the Avars and Lombards agreed peace treaties, which were to hold good for many years, and which made it possible to redeploy troops to the east. It should cause little surprise, then, that an honorific statue was erected in 608 on the pre-existing column, the tallest, in the Roman Forum, by the exarch Smaragdus, who had signed the peace treaty with the Lombards 3 years earlier, in recognition of Phocas's pious benefactions and the peace which he brought to Italy. His armies did, in effect, fight the Persians to a standstill by 606. Khusraw was forced to increase the forces which he could put into the field before resuming what turned out to be a battle of attrition lasting 3.5 years, 607 to 610. He owed his success ultimately to superior numbers and the opportunity which they gave his generals to strike where and when they chose, thus negating the Romans' advantage of inner lines, or even turning it against them if feints succeeded in drawing away reserves from targeted sectors of front. Khusraw could be confident of the outcome from 607, but not of the length of time which it would take to break the will of the Roman armies. His confidence must have been strengthened by news from within the East Roman Empire. A rebellion initiated in North Africa by the governor Heraclius in 608 developed into an empire-wide revolutionary movement in the course of 609 and 610. Political uncertainty was bound to have an effect on the morale and fighting ability of the armies in the field. With a bridgehead across the Euphrates at Zenobia, from which attacks might be launched into Syria, and with troops poised to cross the Euphrates at other places, it would only require a temporary abatement in Roman military effort for the breakthrough to be achieved, and for Persian forces to drive west to Antioch, the greatest city of the Levant, and to the Mediterranean coast beyond. 2. The Heraclian Revolution. Danger threatened the East Roman Empire from within as well as without in the last years of Phocas's reign. Several opposition groups came out into the open. The targets of their attacks were various: the state itself, the regime in power, local city establishments, and rival local organisations. The gathering crisis reached a climax in autumn 610 and the following winter, when a new emperor took over at the centre and, in the face of considerable opposition, imposed his authority on the provinces. It was prolonged into the first years of the new reign, despite the menacing advance of Persian power deep into the Levant, only abating after 614, when Persian occupation forces were entrenched in Syria and the north of Palestine. It is reported that in 609 or 610, the Jews of the Levant were suspected of planning a general uprising, which, by diverting forces away from the eastern front, would have provided invaluable aid to the Persians as they fought their way through the defences of Roman Mesopotamia, or sought an opportunity to establish a bridgehead across the Euphrates. When trouble erupted on the streets of Antioch and many of the city's political bosses were slaughtered, one rumour, picked up by a later source, had it masterminded by Jews, holding them responsible for the murder of the patriarch Anastasius and for the mutilation of his corpse. Later, in 614, those of Jerusalem were charged with being an enemy fifth column, responsible for urging the Persian high command to besiege the city, and subsequently exploiting the fall of the city to launch a ferocious attack on their Christian fellow citizens and to desecrate the holy places. The open political challenge to Phocas's regime originated in the West. The beginning of the rebellion is datable to 608. The leaders were the elder Heraclius, exarch of Africa, his brother Gregory, and their sons Heraclius and Niketas. Their first moves took place after assurances of support were received from several quarters in neighbouring provinces. At the time, or soon afterwards, a story began to circulate which put a rather different construction on the rebellion, suggesting that its mainspring was a party in the Senate in Constantinople. It is, however, plain that from the first, the political initiative lay with the African provincial leadership, that it acted as the catalyst for the opposition elsewhere with its swift and successful attack on Alexandria, and that it never relinquished its directing role in the events which were to bring about Phocas's downfall. It is unclear how long the battle for Egypt lasted after the intervention of Bonosus, the regime's hard man, or how large were the forces deployed by the two sides. The fullest account, that of the Egyptian chronicler John of Nicu, is alas rather blinkered, and seems to concertina time. It is therefore hard to tell how many troops were withdrawn from the Eastern Front, and what the impact was on the Roman war effort. The established social order within the localities was being subjected to stress. Brief but highly coloured reports in the extant sources suggest that the traditional rivalry and propensity to violence of the circus factions burst out into rioting and gang warfare on the streets of the great cities of the Middle East. This appears to have spread rapidly, a successful insurrection in one city inspiring the youth of others to emulate it, so that by the end of Phocas's reign, the crisis was so intense and widespread that it was registered by a distant observer in the far west Isidore of Seville. There is also clear evidence of political polarisation between the factions, from Antioch in 609, where Blues feared the consequences of their association with Phocas, and later that year from Egypt, where Blues were ready to back the regime of Phocas in one city, Manuf / Onufis, before the arrival of Bonosus with loyalist forces, and were attacked by Greens after his defeat. Rival loyalist and pro-rebel parties within the governing elites of some Egyptian cities may have helped stir up the local circus or youth organisations against each other. But factional allegiances were determined primarily by common political stances, transcending city and provincial boundaries. Once activated, the young men soon escaped from external control. The familiar dynamics of a segmentary system took over, pitting gang against gang in an escalating series of violent clashes. The picture thus pieced together is a gloomy one, the only element missing being the hostility of the Monophysite majority among the Christians of the Middle Eastern provinces towards the Chalcedonian orthodoxy of the imperial regime and the local Chalcedonian communities and church hierarchies who benefited from its protection. Historians have, on the whole, agreed in concluding that the crisis was grave, that the defence effort was fatally weakened at a critical juncture, and that the urban basis of Roman civilization was increasingly disturbed. If they are right, much of the credit for the extraordinary success achieved by Persian arms over the following decade or so must be attributed not to the strategy devised and relentlessly pursued by the Persian high command, but rather to the internal divisions of the East Roman Empire. Sociological and cultural explanations, therefore, come to the fore. While the successful application of brute force, which historians are often reluctant to view as a determining factor, is relegated to a subsidiary role. If the future course of the war is to be understood, it is essential to examine this body of evidence and the modern consensus resting upon it with a critical eye. The first step is to handle the polemical material about Phocas with care. The second is to see which, if any, of the three major problems said to have faced the East Roman authorities Jewish Fifth Column, empire-wide conspiracy leading to open rebellion on the periphery and widespread urban disorder, is securely documented. The third is to assess the extent to which the war effort was hampered by these domestic...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.